Good morning and welcome to Mission of Grace Church. I'm Pastor David, and we welcome you in the name of God our Father and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We came to worship God together. Amen. Is that why you came? I hope so. This morning we come to Psalm 103, and when you read Psalm 103 as a Christian, you breathe a great sigh of relief. It says this from verse 8 through 18. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. Wow. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love to those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we are in awe. We are humbled at this beautiful truth. Father, we know that we are duty-bound to do your will. And Lord, so often we do our own. We do what is contrary to what you tell us, what you say in your word. But we are so thankful that you do not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities, because the penalty of our numerous sins has been paid at Calvary. And so this morning, Lord, we rejoice. We worship you. May we do so in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Lord, for all you have done for us. Lord, you did so because you loved us. And now let us love you. Bless our service today unto you and, Lord, unto us. These things we ask in Christ's holy name, and all God's people said, Amen.
Ransom captive Israel.
Again, this time directly for our spiritual need. Our Father, our God, we love you, Lord. And that's something we can say, if we can say it from the heart, because you have first loved us. You chose us before the foundations of the world. You chose us not because of who we are, but because of who you are. And now we are yours. And Lord, we are eternally grateful that we are, that you are our Heavenly Father, that you are perfect, that you will ordain everything for us, that you mete out prosperity and adversity and everything in between as you see fit. We know that the things that you ordain are right. Everything you do is right. Lord, many things we do are wrong. We are apathetic, indifferent. We set ourselves above you. We have trouble in our relationships. The fall has pervaded our lives. But Lord, you are restoring us. You are sanctifying us. And we pray as we lay our hearts bare this morning that you would sanctify us through and through, that you would transform our hearts and minds, that you would work in our thinking, in our living, in our acting, in our being, that we would bring honor and glory and praise to you, that we would be examples of your grace wherever we go. And if anyone here this morning is a stranger to grace, I pray that they wouldn't be very much longer. Father, for those who need healing, for those who are mourning, we pray you would help them, that you would comfort those who mourn, and that you would heal those who are sick. At the end of the day, Lord, give us the grace and strength to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. These things we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Now it's time just to make mention of remembering for tithes and offerings. The needs of this church continue during this remote ministry. And there's a couple of ways that you can remember to give, either by visiting our website, missionofgracechurch.org, or mailing directly to 358 Pleasant Street, Gardner, Massachusetts.
Would you please turn to Luke 19:45? Luke 19:45. We'll be reading to verses 20, verse 8. I'm glad you're in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm glad I am. Right? It's only because of his grace. If it wasn't, if his grace wasn't meted out to us, we could be some other places, not so good places. Maybe just laying in bed, indifferent, apathetic. But no, you brought us here as we have been brought to him. Hear now the word of God. And he, that's Jesus, entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold, saying to them, "It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." And he was teaching daily in the temple. The chief priests and the scribes and the principal men of the people were seeking to destroy him. But they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were hanging on his words. One day, as Jesus was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes with the elders came up and said to him, "Tell us by what authority you do these things, or who is it that gave you this authority?" He answered them, "I will ask you a question also. Now tell me, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man?" And they discussed it with one another, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say, 'Why did you not believe him?' But if we say from man, all the people will stone us to death, for they are convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it came from. And Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things? The Word of God. Have you ever seen somebody playing whack-a-mole? You know the whack-a-mole game where the moles pop up and you hit one, and then as the game goes on, more moles popping up and you're hitting them, and the longer the game goes, the more quickly and more erratically the moles pop up. Life is like whack-a-mole for some people. There you stand, just waiting for the next problem to pop up, the next crisis to arrive. And you're only hoping that you're fast enough to react to it before another mole pops up, the next and the next. Everybody's got problems, right? Everybody. And we know that that's true because the world is corrupted and has been since the fall. Human solutions to problems are often temporary and lead to other problems. If you've ever had major surgery, you know that there are side effects of things, that one thing affects another. Enter the King of Kings, the Lord Jesus Christ, God. God is love. I remember some days ago, long time ago, I used to preach at a hospital as a chaplain sort of thing. And I did it for 11 years, once a month, local hospital. And the thing that was there was a mental hospital. There wasn't many of those around. It was the fifth floor. And the fifth floor would come to the chapel on Sunday afternoon. And the people that were there were people from all walks of life, Christians sometimes that I had seen before, strangers, all kinds of people, sometimes kind of notable people who had mental health problems, and they came there to hear the word. And you'd be amazed. They'd say, wow, if this person didn't have this kind of problem, they'd never walk into this little chapel inside the hospital. But I used to do the worship too, and I'd sing three songs and do a sermon. And every Sunday, it was my practice for the most of the times I was there, to do the old song from the 70s that I think Andre Crouch wrote. It's called Jesus is the Answer. It goes like this. Jesus is the answer to the world today. I wanted those people to know that whatever they were going through, Jesus is the answer, isn't he? He is the answer. He is the solution to our problems. And so, there was a movie, The Return of the King. It was a famous trilogy from Lord of the Rings. And there's one scene that we used to reenact at home. Very simple. The king was sitting on the throne, and he put out his hand with his ring, his signet ring, and the guy came over and kissed his ring, and he said, fealty with love. Fealty means loyalty to the king. So here was the subject coming to this king and offering his loyalty. And with love, and the king was extending his love, his beneficent love as well. We are like that as we come to King Jesus, fealty with love, loyalty to him. We submit ourselves to him, for he is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other way. There's no other greater truth, and there is no better life than to be under him. Now get this, that sounds good until we get here. Under his authority. Under his authority. You see, we have authority too, don't we? We have authority. We can do things. We can do many things. We can do what we want. But God has authority, and he's given us a measure of authority. We have authority over our lives. Maybe we have authority over our children. We have authority in our job sphere. But are you living under his authority? Because if you're living under his authority, that brings true and lasting freedom. It's a paradox. You would think that if you live the way you want to live, you would be free. But what will happen, essentially, is you will be entangled in misery. But if you live under his authority and surrender your own to his, you'll be blessed. The world does not understand it. They don't get it. People in the church don't either. Not lots, but some people in the church. Now here we see Jesus coming into the temple, and he's turning over tables and driving out people. And we look at this and say, wow, Jesus is mad. Yes, he was. He was angry. And he did something about it. You see, God is perfectly righteous and supremely worthy of worship. We are always culpable if we fail to give him the full honor and praise that he deserves. And it's especially true when it comes to our relationship with Jesus Christ. Do we acknowledge him as the king of our world? You might say he's the king of kings, but is he the king of your world? 365 days a year, 24 hours a day. Is that evident in the choices you are making? Now, if we do not honor Christ as king, if we don't submit to him as king, that calls into question whether our relationship with him is true, whether our faith is saving faith. How sad it is that some people get close to Jesus, but they don't go all the way. They never trust him as Lord and Savior, never receive him as their king, and so never reach the joys of heaven. It is so sad that it made Jesus weep. Never imagine that God is unmoved by lost sinners. He is not. He's shown his compassion in Christ. He weeps for us if we are lost in our sins. He weeps for us as he wept in Jerusalem on that day as he came in and triumphantly entered the holy city. When was the last time, beloved, you cried tears of concern for those in your world who are not saved? When was the last time? That convicts me. Doesn't it convict you? As I stand here right now, convicts me. I wish the Lord would just break my heart more for sinners, lost sinners. Is that your prayer as well? That God would break your heart? Because people are going to hell as surely as I'm standing here. And we lose sight of that fact, don't we? We lose sight of it. And to be indifferent to lost sinners is not Christ-like. Christ is not indifferent. Jesus not only had a passion for the lost, but he had a consuming zeal for worship. You see, he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold, saying, "It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." Luke begins in the temple. The very book begins at the temple. When the angel appears to Zechariah in the holy place and heralds the first good news. And Jesus went to the temple several times, once in infancy for purification, once in adolescence to dialogue with the scribes, and once as a man to withstand the temptations of Satan. Now, at the end of his earthly ministry, he has come into Jerusalem, into the temple, for the last time. His coming is the fulfillment of Malachi's ancient prophecy, quote, "And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple." This is it, right here, this morning. And coming to the temple, Jesus was coming to a magnificent building of splendor, of white stone. Everything was grand and perfect and awesome. It was dazzling. It was a building of profound spiritual significance because the temple was the dwelling place of God on earth. And if you wanted to come and meet with God, you went to the temple. But the temple had become corrupted. In going to the temple, Jesus was going to the source of Israel's spiritual problems. What he found there made him angry. He overturned tables, threw chairs. And Mark adds that he wouldn't allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. Luke's account is somewhat more brief, but it simply says this, that Jesus began to drive out those who sold. Jesus was there to clean house. What made him so mad? It had something to do with the buying and the selling. It was almost Passover, you see. And that was one of those holy days when you had to go to Jerusalem, if you could. And you were to offer unblemished animals to sacrifice. And all of the men needed half shekels to pay the temple tax and local currency. So there were people in the court of the Gentiles who were money changers. They were basically giving you the currency you needed. And the exchange rate was not often very fair. Think of it of you going to an event and getting a bottle of water and spending $5. How much is the water? It's $5. You can get this in a grocery store for probably 15 cents. But you go to an event, and they got you captive, right? Because you're there. You can't get water anywhere else. You're not going to dig a hole in the ground. And they say, yeah, it's $5. There you go. And so this is what was happening. There was a lot of, and by the way, these things were needed for worship, but they were crowding out the Gentiles from the court of the Gentiles, such that the Gentiles couldn't get to God, you see. Here's the point. Commercialization of religion is wrong. The church is not a business. Worship is not a commercial activity. And if we as a church start getting into commercial activities and inadvertently even prevent people from getting to God, then we are sinning. Now, you come into this church, you say, yeah, you know, there's nothing going on here. But did you know when people are building churches today that they're putting them in with coffee houses, maybe coffee franchises, with gymnasiums, with gift shops, with food courts, with all kinds of things, like malls? They look like malls. They don't want them to look like churches. They want them to look like a mall. For lots of reasons, they do that. And so, if we turn the church into a profit-making business off of people's need for God, we do something very heinous. That's why you can't go to many channels on daytime TV and find anything worth watching. It's all health and wealth, prosperity gospel stuff, where, you know, subtly money's more important, or God's just a vehicle to get you the money you need to pay your electric bill, or something of that nature. You see, we don't make money off of people's spiritual need, right? We're not doing that. Christ is not a commodity. The gospel is not for sale. Buying and selling are a symptom of a deeper problem. He says this, and he's quoting from both Isaiah and Jeremiah. He says, "My house shall be a house of prayer." And if you add the whole thing from Isaiah, a house of prayer for all peoples. In some versions, for the Gentiles, for all the nations. So here are the Gentiles. They can't really even come in. They can come into the court of the Gentiles, but they can't get in because of all this commercialism. They can't get to God. Christianity shouldn't do the same thing. It's an era for us to load Christianity with commercialism that people can't even get to God. They're prevented because of all this commercial veneer. You know, think about Christmas time. I love that post on Facebook where you've got the picture of those tankers, freighters, sitting out in ports, trying to get into ports, right? And caption says, you know, no Christmas this year because all these freighters can't get into port and unload all our junk that we bought on Amazon, you know. And it's like, have people commercialized the incarnation of Jesus Christ? And you can't even get to it. One of the most famous sermons that I ever uttered here was simply this: what Christmas is all about. It's like the top three sermons on sermon audio around the world. What Christmas is all about. Why? Because people are saying, I don't know what Christmas is all about. I really don't even know. I really don't even know. We've commercialized it so much that you can't even get to the true meaning of it. And it's wrong. So we have to be very careful that we don't turn our church into a supermarket, ever, right? And then he's talking about, you know, you've made it a house, a den of robbers. It's supposed to be a house of prayer for all the nations, but you've made it a den of robbers. So in Jeremiah's day, the church was a place where the criminals could go and hide out. In the same way, we have people today who are committing white-collar crimes, and they're hanging out in churches. Hucksters, you know. And we don't want any part of that, do we? Listen, folks, we want to be the real deal. We want to worship God as he says. We want to worship God. We want to make the main business of our life the life of faith, don't we? Not a piece of our life, a compartment. Oh, I work very big. I got a big job at so-and-so place, and I go to church on Sundays, give them an hour or an hour and a half, whatever it may be. No, 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 no. The main business of your life is the faith once delivered to all the saints, and you just happened to do these other things, and they should be all subordinate to your relationship to Jesus Christ. Even your relationship with your spouse, right? Everything should be subordinate to your relationship with Jesus Christ. This, the worship of God, is the marketplace of the soul. We come this morning. Make sure, now by the way, there's no temple anymore. If you go over to Jerusalem, you won't find it. Where's the temple now? Right here. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Make sure that you're in a temple is a house of prayer and a place of honesty. Number two, the church is a teaching center. Because after Jesus cleans house, what does he do? He starts preaching and teaching. Now, a church and a temple are not the exact same thing, but that's what's going on, right? This church, our church, is a teaching center. You come here to be taught. I come here to teach myself and yourself, right? That's what we're doing. We're not here to run bazaars. We're here to learn of God. Amen? And the focal point of that is the Sunday sermon. That's the biggie. And so, where God's word is read, where Christ is present, where the Holy Spirit works on souls, that should be the church. We shouldn't become a social club. We're not the Elks or the Eagles or whatever. That's not who we are. We believe in fellowship, but we're not a social club. The church is a teaching center. It's the pillar and buttress of the truth. And we come to teach and to learn of God. A teaching center, a church, is to be led by an equipped minister, right? Not just anybody gets up here, but an equipped minister went through a period of time where he was called to the gospel and was prepared, perhaps in a seminary. Number two, it provides ample time for teaching. You know, we're not one of those churches where we worship for 95% of the morning and the sermon is a 5-minute homily. There'd be no time for the preaching of the word. Number three, it understands teaching not merely as informing, but equipping. Think about this. Preaching is not the same as a lecture. There are some churches, few, that you can go to, you'll get a lecture. But preaching is not the same as lecturing. This is not a lecture. What's the difference? Well, Scripture is useful for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. All those things, the pastor-teacher must equip the saints for the works of the ministry Sermons must explain not only the what of the text, right? I could simply explain to you why Jesus did what he did, stop there. But I added what it means to us now, because that's the so what of the text. There's the what of the text and the so what of the text. They used to call it the use. The Puritans, when they preached, they'd call it the use. Today we call it the application. Every sermon must have application, not just at the end of the sermon as an afterthought. I used to sit under that preaching. It was heavy on exposition, but application sometimes wasn't even got to. No. I want to weave application through every sermon that you hear, you see. And a teaching church is committed to being a learning church. I hope you don't come to church and say, let's just get it over with. I hope you're here, and there's some parts of the world where there'd be people that sit here for 3 hours if you preached to them. That's not Americans, of course. We got things to do. You got something in the crock pot. But don't get upset because the service went over 10 minutes. You know, oh, goodness, we went over. Come on, really? If that's where you're living, then you got a big problem. And I'm not up here to be long and uninteresting, I hope. But we want to hear Christ and we hear him proclaimed. All the people, when Jesus taught them, were hanging on his words. They listened intently. And what was happening? They were passionate because he was passionate. He was a man of passion. Now what happens? Here he is. Here's Jesus. See the scene. He comes in. He cleans house. He starts preaching daily. And what do? There's a group of folks looking for a chance to kill him. To kill him. That's like one of you being out there saying, I'm going to kill him. I don't know when, but I'm going to blow him away. Pretty easy up here, right? You know, stand up. Be quick. But the point is this. Every spiritual advance is opposed by the enemy of our souls. Every time we go to advance spiritually, the enemy opposes that advance. These men hated Christ. They envied Christ. Every time you go to do something good in this world for Christ, truly for Christ, if you don't feel fellowship with your master, you're going to be very upset. Oh, they never said thank you. I did this and no one ever gave me anything. They never gave me a gift. They never sent me a card. They didn't appreciate me at that church. That's why I left it. Beloved, they didn't appreciate Jesus. They were trying to kill him. And you know, sometimes, like, you know, we have events at the church, and I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes, but you know, like a thing where we have, it's the annual barbecue. And it's a big deal in our church, right? We have a barbecue in the summer, and people come out, you haven't seen them in 74 years. Hey, I'm here for the barbecue. And somebody said to me, oh, they only come for the food. And I'm like, yep, that's true. But it happened to Jesus too. Remember the loaves and the fishes? They only came for the food. And you're in good company if you're the pastor of that church, because hey, it happened to Jesus, it's gonna happen to you as well. There'll be people that come for the food. And I have any problem with that. You know why? Because they came and they get to hear if their ears aren't stopped up. And so, don't get all hung up on, oh, nobody appreciated what I did. They didn't send me a letter or a cart. Do it as unto the Lord. Amen? None of this weird, I'm offended stuff, right? Love covers a multitude of sins. Be careful about being offended. Oh, I was offended. Goodness gracious. Really? You were offended? Be offended. Let it hurt. Cry to Jesus and get into spiritual warfare, because we're in a war. Right now, as you sit here and I am preaching to you, your mind wants to go somewhere else. I know. I sat in a pew too. And Monday morning, I live by to-do lists, and I had my to-do list in my mind, and I used to be going, get the to-do list out. I need to hear the sermon. Get the to-do list out. I don't have that problem today because I happen to be up here, but if I was down there, that could be happening to me, particularly if you had a jury trial, right? Oh, did I do this? Did I do that? Did I forget that? Spiritual warfare. Jesus has won the war. Battle from victory. Know what that means. Lastly, and most importantly, the Great Commission says, Jesus says, that all authority in heaven and earth is given to him. Jesus has all the authority. The problem with the religious leaders is the same problem that we have. His authority confronts our authority. Oh no, Jesus, that's my authority. At first, maybe it's just an irritating sermon, makes me uncomfortable. I don't know, he's putting his some finger on my raw nerve here. Perhaps you have an encounter with a Bible passage and it steps on your toes, or your level of discomfort goes up. You realize, as I did so many years ago, that if he takes over your life, there's going to be some radical changes, and you're not sure you want to give up control. You don't want to let go. You don't want to submit yourself to his authority. You like his authority a little bit, but not too far, Jesus. No, sir, not that. I need that. I want that. I can't give that up. And what happens is, when people get to the point where that's going to happen, they make all kinds of excuses for why, I can't do that. I need to go to someplace else. I can't go to church anymore. I can't sit in the pew. It's too hard, or it's too long, or I don't have transportation. I don't drive. The list goes on and on. Right? We have an endless capacity to self-rationalize. Right? It's unbelievable. And it doesn't help you, because you're only lying to yourself. And you're the one who pays the price, ultimately. You want to pay the price? I don't. Jesus paid the price. I want to have that be happening when I stand at the bar, not me paying the price, because I know what that is about. So, life is a big question. We're seeing it right now played out all over America. Who has the right? You shall take the vaccine. You don't have the right. This is my body. I decide if I'm jabbed with your vaccine. Keep your laws off my body. It's my pregnancy, and I'll decide what happens. There's a difference between those two things, isn't there? There just so happens to be somebody else in the pregnant woman. Somebody who is genetically distinct. Another person who has rights that are not being honored. it would seem. Now, we love to justify ourselves. We love to. We assume we know what's best for us. We assume we know what's best for our well-being. We think this is the way to go. I have authority. This is the decision I'm making. This is what I'm going to do. Who is this Jesus, by the way? He comes in and he's trying to overturn the tables in my life. And I won't let him. Because I get to say, I judge God. I tell you whether the Bible's true. I tell you whether Jesus is right. See? Notice how that happens? The person, the created person, says, I'm the authority. God, you're not the authority. And that's so wrong. And it doesn't work. Ever. It doesn't work. Because there are only two sources of authority, God and humans. And human authority has been delegated by God, you see. It's been given by God. So they ask him, Jesus, by what authority are you doing this? And he asks them a question. Was John the Baptist? And this baptism, was it from heaven or was it from not from heaven? Was it of God or not of God? The people thought it was of God. And they said, well, if we say this, then that. If we say no, then this, the people will kill us. We can't really. What they were doing is, we can't answer truly, because if we do, we're going to cause a terrible consequence. It happens today when people are on the stand, when they're testifying. You ask them a question, were you home that night or not? That's an easy question, right? Yes, I was, or no, I wasn't. They'll sit there and think about the implications of the answer. And people, I've seen it happen question after question. And guess what? They get themselves tangled up. It's not true. They knew the answer, who the final authority, who the society's, the world's authority is, but they didn't want to admit it. Do you admit it in practice? You may admit it with your words, but do you admit it in practice? That's the question for you today. Do you admit his authority in practice? None of us does perfectly, because they call it sin. None of us is sinless. We're sinful. But we are to repent of our sin, and we are to fight against our sin, and we are to renew our emphasis on God's word, hence his authority, because his authoritative word confronts our sin. It confronts our selfishness. Paul said this to preachers. He said, reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. Preaching that does not reprove, rebuke, and exhort people regarding sin is not biblical preaching. It may be that the biggest church in America does not have biblical preaching in it, because sin is never mentioned nor preached against. Preaching that avoids confronting sin and just makes people feel good is not pleasing to God. Calvin pointed out that when preaching on 2 Timothy 3:16, preaching that picks the verses that meets people's fancy and neglects the verses that confront how they live is not biblical preaching. It's rampant It's all over the church. I can't go there as long as I'm breathing. I can't do that. I won't do that. I don't care if I'm preaching to four people. I won't do it. Why? Because I'm old, sick, infirm, and I'm going to stand before Jesus and be judged more strictly than you. That's why. And I won't do that. I won't commit pastoral malpractice to the people I love and call to shepherd. I can't do it. I won't do it. Calvin argued that the faithful pastor needs to use enough vehemence that people realize that this ain't a game. This is not a performance. This is not a game. This is real. This is life. Johnny Erickson Tata was a happy 17-year-old girl who dived into water that was not deep enough, and she broke her neck, paralyzing her from the neck down. That was a long time ago. In the months that followed that accident, she struggled hard with hard questions for the Lord, like few of us had to do. One of them was, "By what authority do you do this to me?" But as you read of her struggle, she makes it clear that if the accident never happened, she probably would have gone on being a nice church-going girl who professed to believe in God, but who ran her life according to her own self-centered goals and desires. God forcefully confronted her with his right to be the sovereign Lord of her life. As a result, she has had a worldwide impact for Jesus for decades. If you asked Johnny, you said to her, "Would you rather have that undone, or would you rather have what happened to you happen?" She would say, "Oh no, I wouldn't change a thing." Has the Lord upended any tables in your life? Has he stopped you in your tracks? Shocked you? Maybe you weren't doing anything, you know, blatantly illegal, but you were just living with this self-centered thing. It's so easy to do, isn't it? We're so self-centered, and it's natural. God-centeredness is supernatural, not, right? It's, you can't be God-centered without something happening to you from God. People just don't wake up and say, "I'm not going to be self-centered today, I'm going to be God-centered." No, that's not the way it works. We know that. We don't just say, "Yes, Lord, whatever you want," unless the Lord has done something in our lives. Amen? Are you with me on that? And so, the Lord Jesus Christ confronts us with his authority by his word, and submitting our lives to his lordship is the issue today. Have you submitted your life to his lordship in everything? Or are there things that are crawling back in, camels that are putting their nose back under the tent that you got to deal with? Sins that you have been beset with, that you need to deal with. We must deal with them. Confronted with the truth, they didn't want to face it, we need to face it. Amen? You got to do business with God. Ryle said this, "The ruin of thousands is simply this, that they deal dishonestly with their own souls. They allege pretended difficulties as to the cause of their not serving Christ, while in reality, they love darkness rather than light and have no honest desire to change. Lord, change me. Lord, change you. Lord, change us. This is our only shot, folks. And every day we have less time than we did yesterday. You realize that? I was talking to the men's group this morning, and we're talking about an 80-year-old brother in the Lord. I love this guy. I was making plans to have lunch with him. I find out he just died. Like, died. He's gone. Christian man. But it was quick. There wasn't a big sickness. There wasn't anything. He just gone. Can happen to you. Can happen to me. As we conclude this, you've heard it maybe before, but it bears repeating. Two battleships were assigned to a training squadron that had been at sea on maneuvers in heavy weather for several days. Frank Koch was serving on the lead battleship, and it was on the watch on the bridge as night fell. The visibility was poor with patchy fog, so the captain remained on the bridge, keeping an eye on all the activities. Shortly after dark, the lookout on the wing reported, "Light bearing on the starboard bow. Is it steady or moving astern?" the captain called out. The lookout replied, "Steady, captain," which meant they were on a dangerous collision course with that ship. The captain then called to the signalman, "Signal that ship. We are on a collision course. Advise you change course 20 degrees. Back came the signal. "Advise you to change course 20 degrees. The captain said, "Send! I am a captain. Change course 20 degrees. Came the reply. "I am a second-class seaman. You had better change course 20 degrees. By this time, the captain was furious. He said, "Send! I'm a battleship! Change course 20 degrees. Back came the flashing light. "I'm a lighthouse. We changed course. The passion of Jesus Christ is to free people like you and me from corruption by confronting our authority with his supreme authoritative word. Fealty with love. Submit to the Lord Jesus. Kiss his ring. Loyally love him and submit to him in surrender. Change course. Living by his authority rather than yours brings true and lasting freedom. Amen." Let us pray. Our Lord and our God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for what the Spirit of God is saying. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to deal with those things in our lives where we have asserted our authority and have not submitted to yours. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to walk with you. We are so thankful, Lord, that you do not deal with us according to our iniquities, that we do not have to repay them, but Lord, we're on a journey called sanctification, and we want, Lord, to be more Christ-like. Why? Because we want to glorify you, because it is right. Help us all, we pray. Give us grace and power to change. In Christ's name, amen.
Once in royal David's city stood a lowly cattle shed, where a mother laid her baby in a manger for his bed. Mary was the mother mild, Jesus Christ, a little child. He came down to earth from heaven, who is God and Lord of all. And his shelter was a stable, and his cradle was a stall. With the poor and mean and lowly lived on earth our Savior holy. For he is our childhood's pattern, day by day like us he grew. He was little, weak and helpless, tears and smiles like us he knew. And he feeleth for our sadness, and he shareth in our gloves. And our eyes at last shall see him through his own redeeming love. Child, so dear and gentle, is our Lord in heaven above. And he leads his children on to the place where he is gone.
And now, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Amen.